Once more, I welcome everybody to the first lecture of Dynaflow 2014. I see a lot of familiar faces, so it's always good, and some new faces. We're happy to present two presenters today, one of which is Frank Bos. He's a colleague of mine. He will discuss the topic of analysis of wealth subjected to fatigue. And we have a very interesting guest speaker today from Applus RTD. He's sitting over there, Niels Brotschken.
Persken.
I'm sorry.
You can call me Niels, that's okay.
Okay. And you will be talking about ultrasonic 3D imaging technique, which was recently, I think, developed by RTD.
So, my name is Frank Bos, and I'm a senior engineer working now for about 5 years at Dynaflow Research Group on a wide variety of subjects. As you may know, at Dynaflow we encounter fluid flows, finite element analysis, but also detailed analysis of wealth subjected to fatigue. So that is the topic of this presentation today. I will start this presentation by providing an introduction to wealth. There will be a general introduction, what welding actually is, and it also explains some welds subjected to fatigue as well. Then I will describe the basics of fatigue analysis using design by analysis, with some reference to the ESMI code. That's the main code that we commonly use for the fatigue analysis of pressure vessels. Then I will describe the general procedure that we use to assess the weld subjected to fatigue according to ESMI and EN design codes, followed by fatigue assessment using finite element techniques. And I will conclude this presentation with a brief introduction to a fitness for surface analysis, which is a nice bridge to the next speaker, because it will illustrate that the measurement techniques are very important. So, well, the fatigue analysis of welds is a very broad topic, so I hope that I will describe the main important topics regarding this this subject. So, welding is, what is welding? Welding is a method, a procedure in order to join two metals by melting the interface of those metals and introducing a filler material. So, in contrast to soldering and brazing, the actually metals to be connected are melted, and filler materials added to form a pool of molten material, and that pool is cooled in a certain way with a certain speed, which also influences the material properties.
Shielded arc welding is usually accomplished by means of an electric arc formed between the work and a coated metallic electrode. Let's see what happens. When the arc is struck, it almost instantly creates a temperature of about 6,500 degrees Fahrenheit. This melts both the base metal and the metal in the electrode. The metal from the electrode is melted off in tiny droplets, is carried across the arc and mixed with the molten base metal. The force of the arc and the forward travel of the electrode causes the mixed molten metal to be pushed to the rear of the crater, where it cools to form a bead. The movement of this metal toward the rear of the crater and the depth of the crater are an excellent check on the quality of the work. The operator should learn to use it as his guide. At the same time that the metal is melting, the coating on the electrode is being consumed. This takes place slower than the melting of the electrode, which shields the arc and helps direct the flow of metal. It also permits the use of higher currents, with the resultant faster deposit of weld metal. A gas is formed, covering the arc with a protective shield that prevents the exposure of the molten metal to the air, and therefore prevents the formation of harmful oxides and nitrides in the deposit. Also from the coating, chemicals acting as cleansing agents enter into the metal to help to remove the impurities. These chemicals with the impurities float to the top, and cooling, form a coating or slag over the bead. This slag causes the molten metal to cool more slowly and has an annealing effect.
This is one of the rare movies showing a nice illustration of the process, which actually happened when you will apply the most popular welding method of shielded metal arc welding, which is used commonly in the design of pressure vessels. The most important aspect of this method is that it uses a consumable electrode. So the electrode generates electronic arc, which generates the heat. And the consumable electrode contains a flux containing a chemical cleaning agent that prevents oxides from forming, and it absorbs the impurities, which are moved to the upper surface of the weld, and you can remove the slag afterwards. The flux also generates an inert gas, protecting the weld pool from environmental contamination. There are also some variants on this method. One is the method without the consumable electrode, so you have to add an additional filler, and then also another method where you actually insert a gas, so it's not generated by the flux. So two important regions are generated: the fusion zone, that's the zone actually melted, so actually the base material is actually melted by the arc, and the heat affected zone, which is very important because the heat affected zone influences the properties of the strength of the welded connection, which is important because that also has some influence on the measured fatigue strength reduction factors that I will show later in this presentation. So the heat affected zone, the properties of that are dependent on the way it is reheated or is cooled, and the properties depend on the base material but also on the filler material. So what happens when we heat the iron? Steel is an alloy of primarily iron, and based on the temperature, it has a certain crystalline structure. So at room temperature, the iron has a ferrite structure. That's a body-centered structure, like in this figure, which is capable of not of including not that much carbon. Carbon is important for carbon steel to have some ductile properties. And when we heat the iron, it forms austenite, that's a gamma phase, which is capable of dissolving much more iron. But you can imagine when we cool the carbon steel, the austenite wants to transform back to the ferrite, and which cannot contain that much carbon, leading to formation of martensite. That's another phase, which causes brittleness of the welded connection. So when you cool the welded connection very fast, you will end up with a weld including a lot of martensite, causing a brittle heat affected zone. But it can be prevented by preheating the connection, but also by controlled cooling of the welded connection. So this is a formula, one of the few formulas in this presentation showing that the amount of heat depends on the speed, the speed of the weld, of the welded process, but also depending on the voltage and the current. And a very high diffusivity of the material causes a high cooling rate, but consequently a smaller heat affected zone. So this is a slide showing some examples of welds, primarily in pressure vessels. So we have some longitudinal and circumferential welds connecting nozzles to vessels. And here you see a pressure vessel containing a lot of different kind of welds in the head, longitudinal and circumferential, but also in the shell. And on the bottom right, you see some fillet welds connecting internals to each other, but also to the shell. Here are some examples of some failures. On the left, you will see a weld failure of a flange connection. So it's a crack in the longitudinal direction at the toe of the weld. And on the right, you see a root opening due to lack of fusion of the weld. So the base materials are not fused completely with the filler material. So the main reasons for weld failure are summarized here. We've got the first one, it's incomplete fusion, like the example on the previous slide. And then we've got lack or excess of penetration of the filler material. So on the right, you see that lack of penetration reduces the throat of the weld and introduces an additional root. Then we've got some impurities. So depending on the melting temperature of the impurities, you will end up with a weld including some voids or some impurities that can cause some solidification cracking. And we've got some porosity, gas entrapped in the solidifying weld metal. Then we have some inclusions, like I showed on the video. The flux can generate some inclusions, which should be removed by removing the slag, because the inclusions are going to the upper face of the weld. But when you make a V-joint by making multiple runs and you forget to remove the slag, you end up with some inclusions inside the weld. And we've got some other topics that I will not describe in more detail: cracking, undercutting, and laminatoring, which is basically use of low quality steel. So when the crack occurs inside the weld, there are basically four different directions that it can travel. The first one is a transverse crack. It's a crack in longitudinal direction. You've got the crack originating at the toe of the weld through the shell or the plate. Then we've got the underbeat crack, which is a crack on the rim between the underbeat and the base plate or the shell. And then we've got finally the root crack, that's a crack initiated at the root of the weld. So before we will continue with the fatigue analysis, we can already do some calculations on the static properties, the static load capacity of the weld, based on the global moments and forces. So for every weld configuration, you will have some global forces and moments that you can transfer to the local forces in the directions perpendicular and in the shear directions, in the longitudinal direction and the shear directions of the weld by using the moment of inertia and the reference areas of this welded connection. By calculating those different components, you can calculate also the resultant, of course, and then the final step is to compare the resultant force to the allowable shear force of the weld metal. That is basically 1/3 of the ultimate tensile strength times the throat of the weld. So the throat of the weld, it's an important parameter because it influences the strength of your weld. So it's very important to know the precise geometry of your welded connection. So there are quite some different weld geometries, but they are all provided on the drawings that you, from the client, or the drawings that were made in order to produce your equipment. So you've got, in this case, on the right, a full penetration weld. But like we showed on the previous slide, when you've got not enough penetration, it's a partial penetration weld, and we will show later in this presentation that the fatigue behavior is very different. The fatigue capabilities is much less for partial penetration weld compared to a full penetration weld. So the wood penetration is important, and in addition to the weld. So besides those analytical calculations, the ESMI code and the B31 piping code also uses the joint efficiency parameter, which is basically the strength of the weld with respect to the strength of the parent metal. So this parameter is 1 for a weld that is as good as the base material, and it's less than 1 for welds that's weaker than the parent metal. This joint efficiency is provided in the code and depends on the weld type and the degree of radiographic inspection, and it's mainly used for governing welds, so longitudinal and circumferential welds, and only for static conditions, so it's not for cyclic load. So now I will briefly describe the some principles of fatigue analysis that we commonly employ in order to assess those welds subjected to cyclic loading. So first question that we can ask ourselves, is fatigue really important? We know from the past that it is really important from some very big disasters, like for example on the right figure, that's a LOA flight in 1988 that causes the complete part of the upper half of the hull to break off in flight. And well, the pilot was very experienced, and luckily he was able to land his aircraft, and only one casualty occurred. And after a detailed investigation, it was shown that the high cycle fatigue of the rivet connection caused the complete riveted connection over half the circumferential direction to fail due to the initiation and the rapid growth of micro cracks. There were some additional studies performed in the past to show that a lot of serious failures were related to fatigue mechanisms, and the majority of the fatigue failures, they occur at welded connections. So basically what happened in high cycle fatigue and in low cycle fatigue, we can consider different failure mechanisms. So in fatigue analysis, basically we make a distinction between low cycle fatigue analysis and high cycle fatigue analysis. Low cycle fatigue analysis basically is related to build up plastic strain inside the structure for a low number of cycles. And on the contrary, high cycle fatigue is related to a very low amplitude of your stress, but in combination with a very high number of cycles. So basically, low cycle fatigue can cause problems below 7,000 cycles, and high cycle fatigue becomes an issue typically for cycles more than 7,000 to 10,000 cycles. So low cycle fatigue is checked against allowable stress related to the yield, but high cycle fatigue is checked against fatigue curves based on experiments performed on smooth bars for a very high number of cycles. So important parameters for fatigue are the mean stress, but also the stress range or stress amplitude, depending on the method that you apply. So in a nutshell again, high cycle fatigue, it's related to crack initiation and propagation, like I showed on the pictures, leading to fracture due to unstable crack growth. And we will analyze high cycle fatigue by capturing the peak stresses in the model that originate at notches, so at the toe of the weld, for example, or the root of the weld. And low cycle fatigue is accumulation of strain. For that, we don't need to resolve the peak stress. No, we only need to resolve the membrane and the bending stresses, so-called structural stress, without the peak stress. So an example how crack initiation can occur. So basically, crack initiation occurs when we have cyclic loading containing a tensile component. that can cause local yielding while still remaining the global stress below the yield. So that's also why we can have fatigue issues for a very large number of cycles, but a very low stress amplitude. So in ductile material, like the material that we normally encounter, additional slip bands on the crystalline structure are generated due to shear deformation in combination with the tensile force induces micro cracks. When we encounter bitter material, there is no yielding, so much less yielding, such that the material is not able to deal with, it cannot absorb a lot of deformation. So when we have initiated the crack, there's a stress concentration present at the tip of the crack, and every time the cycling of the stresses causes a tensile stress, it grows. And when the tensile stress is not there, it stops, but it doesn't reduce, of course. So it will get longer every time that the tensile stress opens the crack. So it's a very, very dangerous, fatigue mechanism, failure mechanism, because you cannot see it for a very long period. So a basic concept that's very important is the stress concentration. So the stress concentration is defined as the stress at the notch divided by the stress away from the notch. So basically this is the stress increase due to the fact that we have, in this figure, that we have a discontinuity. It doesn't have to be a weld, it can also be a hole. Because this is only the general concept of stress concentration. Later I will introduce the fatigue strength reduction factor, which is basically an extension of this. So when we are going to perform a design wear analysis using the codes, there are four different methods. So the first method, it's related to the nominal stress. So basically this is the bending stress in the pipeline, for example. So it's the nominal stress. Structural stress, that's membrane plus bending. The notch stress, that's the peak stress at the point of failure, like number three in this figure. And the hotspot stress, that's the extrapolation of the surface stress. So by using the hotspot stress, which is not very used nowadays, the hotspot stress, you don't resolve the variation of the stress through the wall. So in order to perform a fatigue assessment, you need to make a choice which kind of method you use, and then you will need to perform a multiplication of this stress by the stress intensification factor or stress concentration factor. The SIF, the global geometric peak stress influence. People working with piping, they use it every day. And stress concentration factor, that's what I described on the previous slide. So factors influence fatigue life include load history, notch details, geometric concentrations, surface finish, the environment, the thickness, residual welding stresses, when you have a compressive residual welding stresses that will help preventing high cycle fatigue, and the mean static stress level that's compensated for in the fatigue curves. So depending on the code that you use, the ESME code, the British standard, the EN code, or the piping codes, it is allowed to use certain methods. Basically, I will go into a little bit more detail regarding the structural stress method and the notch stress method that are allowed by the ESME boiling and pressure vessel code. So this is a method that's the nominal fatigue stress method. The first method is basically used by the piping codes using the nominal stress as an outcome of your piping calculation. And in combination with the stress intensification factor, you will be able to perform some expansion or some fatigue calculations. And this hot spot fatigue stress method, that's basically a method that's useful when you have a real singularity in your, for example, two plates are perpendicular to each other, such that it's very hard to solve for the peak stress, and you are only able to perform an extrapolation of the surface stresses. So now I will briefly describe the assessment according to the ESME boiling and pressure vessel code, and I will briefly explain also the possibilities using the EN code. So, like I said in the beginning of this presentation, by the geometry of your weld and the level of inspection, you can also define the fatigue strength reduction factors. And the fatigue analysis using the ESME boiling and pressure vessel code heavily depends on the definition of those fatigue strength reduction factors in combination with a specific fatigue code, fatigue curve. It defines the allowable number of cycles that you are able to sustain for a given stress amplitude. The piping codes, they are based on the Markel experiments conducted on straight pipe with girth welds. For both methods, extensive fatigue testing is necessary in order to obtain those fatigue curves. For low cycle fatigue, it's possible to do some stress linearization to obtain the membrane and bending stresses and then compare those with the material properties. But for high cycle fatigue, you rely on experimentally validated fatigue curves. So basically, there are two different methods present in the ESME code. The Polish bar method, based on the notch stress method. So you are resolving for the peak stress, and then basically based on that, you will determine the allowable number of cycles from the SN curves determined for smooth bars. On the other hand, you will have the you can also use the welded method that uses the master SN curve that is derived for a welded geometry. So the fatigue strength reduction influence is already present inside the fatigue code. So in this case, you doesn't have to resolve for the peak stress. You only have to calculate the structural stress in this case. So the Polish bar method calculates basically, it uses the notch stress. So you have to predict the membrane plus bending plus plus the peak stress using your, for example, your finite element technique. This method can be used for welded but also for unwelded components. So this method is released in before 2007. This is an example of a fatigue curve that you will use for determining the allowable number of cycles. So basically, you will calculate the stress amplitude or stress range, and from this graph, you will, for the specific material, you will define the number of cycles. This code contains a safe design margin of 2 on stress and 20 on cycles that is derived to account for data scatter, but also for environmental effects and the fact that your real geometry is not the same size of your experimental bars. So this is the this graph shows the experimental curve shown by these the fit through the dots. It is shifted down to obtain the design curve conform these design factors, conform the ESME code, but also conform the EN code. So it's not a real safety. The design margin includes effects that are there, but were not taken into account in the experiment. So by performing a fatigue analysis in the ESMI code, you need to define the fatigue strength reduction factor. This is basically the an extension of the stress concentration factor, because it's it is the influence of the welded joint by including not only the stress concentration effect, but also the, for example, the inspection level or the surface roughness, other things that are of influence on the fatigue life. So basically the EN code defines the fatigue strength reduction factor through separate classes defining the fatigue curves according to EN. And in the ESMI code, you will define, depending on the quality level of your inspection, you will have for full penetration weld, partial penetration weld, or fillet weld, you will all have a fatigue strength reduction factor. So basically, what we saw, the quality level depends on the volumetric inspection, surface inspection, and visual inspection. This is something that I will leave to the next speaker. The structural stress method, it's also a method allowed by the later ESMI, editions. This method is very easy to use because you don't have to resolve the peak stress. You only solve for the membrane and bending stresses, like the decomposition of the stress over here. You only use the bending stress and the membrane stress, so you will omit the peak increment, because the effect of the peak is already present in the code. So that means that you can use simplified finite element models. Okay, so this is already what I already said. So no fatigue strength reduction factors are needed. And it's a preferred method, but because the fatigue curves are derived for a specific welded geometry, you need to have approval from the purchaser or the owner of the equipment in order to use this kind of method for the different for the welded connection under investigation. So what we normally do on the fatigue analysis of welds, we perform a fatigue we perform a finite element calculation using different kind of models. So in fatigue analysis, in finite element analysis, we make a numerical model, make a computer model using, for example, beam elements, shell elements, or brick elements. So all those different kind of elements have different kind of freedoms. Beam element is the simplest of the three. Beam element models are encountered in piping programs like CESAR, for example. They only resolve the nominal stress. Shell elements, they resolve linear membrane and bending stresses, and the brick elements, they resolve the full stress, the total stress, the stress intensity, including membrane, the bending, and the peak stress. So the shell and the beam models, they don't capture fatigue stresses, so you definitely need to use a good fatigue strength reduction factor. So you need to have good information on inspection qualities in order to make a sound, an accurate prediction of your fatigue strength reduction factor. So use in the method that I prescribed, the polished bar method and the welded method, you can use these kind of fatigue analyses, but in both methods you use different fatigue curves, but you can use the same methods, same finite element methods. It is an example of a shell model. So this shell model solves for the membrane and bending stresses at this intersection of this nozzle on the head. So what you can do is you can immediately read out the stresses at this intersection, at the location of the weld toe, for example, the location that is plausible to be subjected to failure. And you can multiply that stress with a fatigue strength reduction factor in order to obtain your fatigue stress and compare that stress to the curve for your method to determine the allowable number of cycles and compare that to the number of cycles that you will encounter in for your real operation. So this is an example of a brick model. So basically you will resolve the complete stress field in all your elements. So you see immediately that we've got a singularity at the welt toe. So that's basically the drawback of this method. It's only possible to solve for the peak stress by using very accurate, very smooth mesh. So you really need to have a very higher order model in order to give some accurate predictions regarding the peak stresses. So an alternative is to perform a stress linearization. So basically, in that case, you will cut off the peak stress. So in that case, you will end up with the membrane and bending stresses like you also did in the previous model. But then in that case, you need the fatigue strength reduction factor again. So this is an example of a line over which you can do a stress classification line. You can perform a linearization on this line in order to obtain your membrane and bending stress opposed to this very fine mesh that you use trying to solve for this peak stress. So basically, the method that we commonly use is the method on the left graph, because sometimes it's just too expensive, and also just there are too many uncertainties in resolving the peak stress. So this table shows an overview of these different models, so a shell model and a big model. So the structural stress, basically it's a part of the solution, but using the brick models you need to perform linearization. And on the right side you see that the peak stress is not there in the shell model. No, you need to apply a fatigue strength reduction factor. But it is part of the brick model. But what we normally use is we perform a linearization in combination with fatigue strength reduction factor. So when we have performed fatigue analysis for one load cycle, the main you may have to extend your method to assess all your load cycles that you encounter. So basically, a pressure vessel is subjected to different load cycles. It can be due to temperature differences, can be due to cycling of the pressure during the day or during the night. So you will have to identify those different stress ranges caused by those different load cycles. And you can combine the effect of the fatigue stresses by using the cumulative damage approach, using Miner's rule. So basically you will calculate the number of cycles that you calculate by what you would like to use. And you are summing up all the effects of the different load cycles, and when you are lower than one, it's satisfied. So sometimes it's very hard to obtain the number of cycles. There are several methods defined in both the EN but also the ESMI code in order to give a prediction of the number of cycles for each different load range or stress range, like the rainflow counting methods, for example. So now I will show you two examples to conclude this part of the FEA analysis. So basically what you are seeing here is an example of a floating head connection to a floating tube sheet as part of a heat exchanger. So we were asked to solve for the fatigue properties of the weld connecting the shell with the floating tube sheet. Basically there were two different load cycles present. So the pressure was cycling from 0 to 20 bar during the night, and was cycling from 0 to 15 bar during the day at constant temperature, and the required number of cycles was 25,000 for each cycle. We used carbon steel and the fatigue curve corresponding to this particular method. And the objective was to check the full penetration V weld regarding high cycle fatigue. So we need to resolve the peak stress induced, so we can resolve the peak stress by performing a detailed model using brick elements. But in this case, we indeed used a brick model, but we chose to linearize the stress and combine that with the fatigue strength reduction factor using the ASME code. So for both stress ranges, we performed numerical simulations using our finite element software, obtaining the structural stress range of 240 megapascals and 133 for the night cycle. On the next slide, I will show you the background of the fatigue strength reduction factor that we used. But we applied a factor of 1.5, leading to a fatigue stress range of 360 megapascals, combine that with 200 megapascals. So we started by looking into the ASME code, what kind of fatigue strength reduction factor to use. And the difference between the ASME code and the EN code is that that the fatigue strength reduction factor defined in the ASME code is not taking into account the loading conditions or the geometrical effects. Now, it's basically a function of the inspection quality levels. So for a full penetration weld through a shell, which is grounded and obtained a full inspection, through volumetric surface and visual, you will have a fatigue strength reduction factor of 1. And if it's not machined, it's 1.2. The EN code, on the contrary, also specifies the influence of the geometry and the loading conditions by using cartoons. And then, in that case, you can apply those cartoons two different ways. You can also construct the fatigue curve based on the EN code using this class. So it's a class. But what we did, we translated the fatigue curve to an ASME fatigue strength reduction factor in order to make a comparison, and in this case we ended up with a fatigue strength reduction factor of 1.5 because of the influence of the rounded hub. So using that fatigue strength reduction factor, we performed a cumulative damage approach on the right using this fatigue curve in order to find that it passes this requirement. Okay, so to conclude this presentation, I will briefly describe some slides in some slides the fitness of surface for surface method that can be used in addition to fatigue analysis, like I showed you using finite element calculations. But I'm sure that the next speaker will also say something about this. So fitness for surface assessment, basically, it's a quantitative engineering evaluation to determine if a surface or an equipment that's already in service is safe and reliable at specific conditions for a certain time. So you need a fitness for surface analysis for several reasons. The first reason is that, for example, the asset or the equipment already exceeds the design that it was designed for, and you want to extend the design, the life of the design, but you don't have the information that was used when building the equipment. Second part is that you will decommission the asset for different service. So it has a next goal. Maybe it was turned off and stand there for a couple of years, and then you want to use it again for something for a different purpose. Then you would like to do a fitness for service analysis. The third reason is that you have some equipment operating at very high temperatures or cyclic surface, or that the equipment has gone a serious event. So for example, a fire, or overloading, or failure. Or that, last reason, that you performed some inspections, and the inspection showed some flaws, some cracks, some deformations, In all those reasons, it's worth to do a fitness for service analysis in order to figure out what the status of your equipment is and how long you can operate the asset. So before 2000, there was no standard for fitness for service analysis. So basically in 2001, the ESME and the API, they formed a committee in order to define rules in order to perform a fitness for service analysis. So you can use the API 579, that was the result of that committee, in order to perform this analysis in combination with an ESME or API standard for pressure vessels, for piping, but also for tanks, storage tanks. So the API 579 consists of 13 parts, all relevant for subjects that may compromise the functioning of your equipment, like for example general metal loss, pitting corrosion, weld misalignment, dents, fire damage, and what we are mostly use is part 9 for the assessment of crack-like flaws. So when you performed an inspection and you found some flaws or some cracks in your equipment. So basically, part 9 of API 579 allows you to perform three types of assessments in order to figure out whether the size of the measured flaw is critical or not, and if it's critical, or not, it determines how long you will operate. You are safe to operate, or that you should repair it, of course. So level 1 is the most basic method of the three. So it's limited to certain geometry. So the wall thickness should be less than 38 millimeters. You can only use structures that are subjected to membrane stresses, and of course you also got some material limitations. On the other hand, you have a level 2 and level 3 assessment that use the finite element calculations as the basics to determine the global stresses, so primary, secondary, and residual stresses for level 2, and it calculates a diagram in order to check whether or not the crack length and the crack depth and width are allowed. Level 3 is much more advanced because level 3 actually calculates that diagram. I will show you the diagram on the next slide. So level 3 really calculates the growth of your crack. So you need to do some very detailed plastic calculations in order to perform a level 3 calculation. So in the level 2 calculation, you use the failure assessment diagram in order to investigate the relation between the toughness of your material, so the amount of deformation that your material with the crack can accommodate in relation with the plasticity ratio, which is basically a load ratio that's related to the material properties like the yield. So this diagram can be calculated in a level 3, but it's also provided for typical materials in a level 2 assessment. So besides determining the diagram, you also need to have a very detailed measurement of your flaws, because you can combine flaws. You need to know whether it's an embedded flaw or it's a surface flaw. And you also need the material properties that are typically known for your material, but you need to take this into account in a level 3 assessment as well, because in that case you will have some strain hardening as well. So basically 6 steps. First is loading and stress conditions. You need to determine those. The second step is you need to determine the material properties at the operating conditions that you encounter your your flaw or your crack. Step three is specify the crack type, the number, but also the dimension and the orientation. So it's very important because those parameters, they influence the calculation of your actual stress intensity, your toughness ratio, and your plasticity ratio in order to check whether or not your configuration lies within the fitness for service diagram and the failure assessment diagram. So basically you determine that point, so the toughness relation to the plasticity, and you check that with the failure assessment diagram. But it all depends on very good volumetric inspection. So in a nutshell, what we saw in this presentation is that there are different ways to perform fatigue analysis using manual calculations and finite element calculations, and in combination with the proper choice of your fatigue strength reduction factor, we saw that it's very important to perform a very good inspection in order to do an accurate fatigue prediction. Depending on the inspection level, the fatigue strength reduction factor according to the SB varies between 1 and 4 for same weld. So it's very important to do a good prediction. And also the reliability of the fitness for service analysis really depends on the accuracy of the flaw dimensions, but also on the measured dimensions like the depth, the length and the width, and the orientation of the embedded flaws. And this is, I think, something that the next speaker will go into more detail. So thanks for your attention.